The topic this evening is of course Richard Nixon, whose tragic presidency is profiled in a new book by Tim Weiner that's receiving lots of attention. Tim is an experienced prize-winning journalist who is of course quite familiar to many here in Washington. He lived and reported here for 15 years, met his wife here, and he's spoken at PNP before for his previous books. He got into the newspaper business after earning a master's degree in journalism at Columbia 36 years ago. By the early 1980s, he had landed at the Philadelphia Inquirer, where he worked for a decade on a range of assignments, both domestic and foreign. And in 1988, won the Pulitzer Prize for National Reporting. It was awarded for a series about a secret Pentagon budget used to sponsor defense research and an arms buildup. And that series led to Tim's first book, Blank Check, The Pentagon's Black Budget. He joined the New York Times in the mid-1990s, covering national security issues, a beat he once described as nukes, spooks, and kooks. During that period, he co-authored a book about the spy Aldrich Ames called Betrayal. Later, he served as a foreign correspondent for the Times in Mexico and traveled on assignment to a range of such other garden spots as Afghanistan, Pakistan, Kenya, the Sudan, and a number of other places. His third book, Legacy of Ashes, A History of the CIA, came out in 2007 and won the National Book Award for Nonfiction. Not long after that, he left newspapering, but not the world of reporting and writing. He's now the director of the Nonfiction Residency Program at the Carey Institute in New York, which is about to open. And he'll also be at Princeton this fall teaching a course on the CIA. And of course, he continues to turn out books on very challenging subjects. 3 years ago, in the book Enemies, he tackled the history of the FBI secret intelligence operations. And in his new book, One Man Against the World, The Tragedy of Richard Nixon, Tim revisits the spectacular fall of one of our most controversial and complicated presidents. Drawing on documents declassified over the past 7 or 8 years, Tim looks back at the Vietnam War and at the Watergate scandal, and most of all, at the tormented, complex figure who was central to those tumultuous years. One review in Kirkus, quote, "No one who reads this incisive book will be nostalgic for Nixon, no matter how disastrous his successors." I did learn just a moment ago that Tim and his family have at least a personal connection to the Nixon years. Tim and his when he was a teenager and accompanied his dad down here to the march on Washington, and when they got back to their car, they noticed someone was parked in the Justice Department, right? And they noticed somebody taking down the license plate number. And Dad worried that, oh, maybe he'd get a ticket. Well, he didn't get a ticket, but he did get audited for the next 3 years. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Tim Weiner.
Thank you, Brad, and thank you, everybody here who works at Politics and Prose. Whether they're selling books, buying books, or reading books, this is one of the greatest bookstores in the United States. I think everybody knows that. And speaking of Nixon's successors, during my years as a reporter, I did have a chance to interview President Ford, who succeeded and then promptly pardoned Richard Nixon, and Jimmy Carter, who was elected after Gerald Ford's short and accidental presidency. And a couple of years later, during the Reagan era, Senator Bob Dole saw at a state event Carter, Ford, and Nixon all gathered together. And he says, "Look, there they are. Speak no evil, hear no evil, and evil."
Mm-hmm.
And on that note, I would like to go to the Wayback Machine about 45 years. And I think many of you will remember this passage in our history. Richard Nixon had been president for 14 months. The war in Vietnam was not ending, as he had promised during his campaign. And he decided to take some extremely drastic measures, which led to a series of disasters unlike any really our country had experienced probably since the Civil War. All right, it's the spring of 1970. Nixon was sleepless, soul-searching. His demonic insomnia returned. "I don't think he ever slept," General Alexander Haig, his military aide, recalled. "He dealt with it at night by drinking. The president by day fell into a dark state of portents and omens. Talking with Chief of Staff H.R. Haldeman about past presidents' auras of omnipotence, he suddenly started planning the precise details of his own funeral. He had predicted that 1970 would be the worst year of his first term. He proved prescient. The president's popularity plummeted 11 points that March. The endless war was the cause. The toll Vietnam was taking was measured not only in military caskets, but in wounds of the mind. An increasing number of veterans were shell-shocked or heroin-addicted. When they returned, they found the war had come home with them. A battle within the American body politic. And all the while, Americans were still dying in combat, 1,000 every month. On March 19, 1970, Henry Kissinger told a trusted colleague about a brutal telephone conversation he had just had with the president. Kissinger told Nixon that there wasn't very much we could do militarily to force Vietnam to settle or surrender. The president went through the roof. Kissinger said he demanded a new set of war plans, a hard option, and he wanted it on his desk that day. Kissinger became frantic. The written notes of a White House War Council convened on March 23rd convey the conundrum. Mr. Helms, the director of the CIA, Dick Helms, Mr. Helms said it, the enemy believed we might bomb North Vietnam, something might be achieved. Mr. Kissinger asked how this message could be conveyed to North Vietnam. General Wheeler, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, said it would be clear if we actually did some bombing. Then came a coup out of nowhere. That week, a right-wing military junta took power in Cambodia. Battle-hardened communist forces started moving toward the Cambodian capital, Phnom Penh, 200 miles northwest of American military headquarters in Saigon. Nixon instinctively embraced the right-wing leader of the Cambodian coup, a general no one knew well but with a name no one could forget, Lon Nol. Quote, President Nixon asked me to draft several personal Nixon to Lon Nol telegrams containing extravagant expressions of friendship and support, recalled Marshall Green, the Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia. I was concerned that Lon Nol would read into those messages a degree of U.S. military support and commitment that exceeded what our government could deliver on, given congressional attitudes in particular. I also regarded Lon Nol as lacking any qualities needed to lead his country out of its mess. Is any of this ringing a bell? As the mess deepened daily in Cambodia, Nixon ordered the CIA into the fight. Quote, I want Helms to develop and implement a plan for maximum assistance to pro-U.S. elements in Cambodia, he instructed. CIA Director Helms promised to support Nixon's military effort against the Viet Cong with untraceable money and guns, Swiss gold, and an arsenal of communist weapons like AK-47 assault rifles. This proved difficult. Cambodia had no American ambassador, no CIA station chief, no CIA or military intelligence officers on the ground. It was terra incognita. Casting around the world, the CIA called upon John Stein, a veteran CIA officer with plenty of paramilitary experience in Africa but none in Indochina. Stein reported back to the White House shortly thereafter. He got straight to the point. Quote, here was another small Southeast Asian country where nobody knew what was going on. Unquote. The new Cambodian regime, quote, had come to the conclusion that somebody had to help them, and this somebody was the United States. With more fighting on their hands, their morale needed bucking up. The only way to give them a bucking up was 10,000 AK-47 rifles and a Swiss bank account. Close quote. Nixon approved 1,500 assault rifles and $10 million in untraceable CIA cash for Lon Nol, a down payment on a far greater commitment soon to come. That same week, America's central outpost in Laos faced a deadly siege by communist soldiers. If it fell, Laos could collapse under communist control. The crisis demanded immediate action, but offered no solution. Kissinger had to plead for the president's attention. Poor K, Haldeman noted sardonically in his March 14th diary entry, no one will pay attention to his wars. And it looks like Laos is falling. On March 15th, Kissinger met for 3 hours with Nixon, Helms, and key members of the National Security Council. The president, Kissinger noted, wasn't inclined to let Laos go down the drain. Helms and the CIA, Helms was blunt. The U.S. and the CIA had to ask the right-wing military junta in Thailand to send battalions of troops into Laos, widening the covert war without telling Congress. The CIA director wrote for the record, apologizing for my vulgarity, this is a quote, I told the president I realized this was a shitty decision to ask the president to make, but in light of all the factors it seemed desirable. Nixon commented that it had been necessary to do a number of unpleasant things recently, and that this was one more that could be taken on as well. There's going to be no announcement, the president said. We're just going to do it. We don't have to explain it. The political situation at home was no better than the military situation abroad. Secretary of Defense Melvin Laird warned Nixon on Tuesday, March 31st, that the Senate was prepared to cut off funds for American airstrikes on Laos and Cambodia. Nixon responded, I will fight such a limitation to the death. The Senate also rejected the nomination of Judge G. Harold Carswell, the second of two third-rate conservatives Attorney General John Mitchell had personally selected for Nixon to elevate to the Supreme Court. A ranking Republican of the Senate Judiciary Committee famously said in support of Carswell, quote, there are a lot of mediocre people and judges and lawyers. They're entitled to a little representation, aren't they? Not on the Supreme Court, the Senate decreed. Nixon blamed Attorney General Mitchell for the politically tone-deaf nominations. The Attorney General's prior selection, Judge Clement Haynsworth, was rejected for his record of racism. But he took his wrath out on the Senate. Quote, multiple unsolvable problems bearing in, Haldeman wrote in his diary. Nixon responded to the Senate's resistance with unalloyed rage. Quote, set up a political attack, he commanded Haldeman. Have to declare war. The president ordered two retired New York City police officers overseen by John Ehrlichman to conduct undercover investigations of his Senate opponents, notably Senators Teddy Kennedy, Edmund Muskie, Birch Bayh, and William Proxmire, four prominent Democrats who fought Nixon's military policies and his Supreme Court nominees as part of what Nixon called, quote, an all-out hatchet jobs on the Democrat leaders, including the use of the Internal Revenue Service to investigate their finances. The ex-cops Nixon's hired were Jack Caulfield, a member of the White House staff handling special assignments like IRS audits, and tough Tony Ulasewicz, who was paid off the books with secret 1968 campaign cash doled out by Herb Kalmbach, Nixon's personal lawyer and political bagman. Tough Tony tailed Teddy Kennedy for nearly 2 years. The Department of Dirty Tricks was on the case. By April 19th, the communists were 20 miles from the Cambodian border of Phnom Penh. President Nixon in Hawaii to greet the astronauts returning from the nearly fatal Apollo 13 moon mission was briefed by Admiral John McCain, the commander-in-chief for the Pacific. Admiral McCain, whose son was still a prisoner of war, captivated Nixon with a hair-raising report. The president ordered Admiral McCain to return with him to San Clemente on April 20th and meet with Kissinger. McCain's briefing was grim. If the communists took Cambodia, South Vietnam would be next, and the war would be lost. McCain emphasized the need for speed in view of the precarious situation. He thought the United States should send every weapon it could find to Phnom Penh. South Vietnam's troops should attack across the Cambodian border, and squadrons of B-52s should bombard the communists. The Joint Chiefs of Staff quickly assembled tons of weapons for the Cambodian army. That was the easy part. Now the president needed a plan for the invasion of Cambodia and the destruction of what the United States called the Central Office for South Vietnam, or COSVN. American war planners envisioned it as the communist nerve center, a bamboo pentagon constructed beneath the jungle canopy. They thought if you could blow up COSVN, you could cripple the enemy's capacity to command and control attacks on American forces in South Vietnam. And Admiral McCain said the United States should destroy it and win the damn war. But Nixon and the Joint Chiefs of Staff never understood that COSVN, the Bamboo Pentagon, was not a place. It could not be bombed. It had no fixed address. It was a small, mobile group of communist officers. They could be located only by the radio signals they transmitted. But that location could only be fixed by the antenna they used for their transmissions, which could be many miles away from the men who were on the air. And the enemy always seemed to know when the B-52s were coming. North Vietnam's intelligence on America's intentions was far better than Americans' intelligence on the enemy. Nixon did not sleep for more than an hour or two on the night of Tuesday, April 21st. Before dawn, he dictated a disturbing note to Kissinger. "I think we need a bold move in Cambodia, assuming I feel the way I do today." It is 5 a.m., April 22nd. "I do not believe Lon Nol will survive. There is, however, a chance he might. In any event, we must do something." Nixon immediately ordered large cross-border attacks by South Vietnam into Cambodia with support from American artillery and fighter jets. He had not yet discussed the question of American ground forces attacking Cambodia. His war councils were split three ways. Secretary of Defense Melvin Laird and Secretary of State Bill Rogers wanted the invasion limited, restricted to the soldiers of South Vietnam. Kissinger favored attack on two Cambodian sanctuaries across the border, but without American ground troops. The military wanted a full assault on Cambodia and the Spectral COSVN headquarters, with American soldiers leading the charge. So did Vice President Spiro Agnew, whose personal qualities included a lack of tact. Agnew said he objected to, quote, "all the pussyfooting." Nixon resented the implication that he was not being tough enough. The pussyfooting remark provoked Nixon to go for an all-out attack with American ground forces. The Joint Chiefs of Staff never drew up a formal plan for the Cambodian operation. There wasn't any time. The next day, the next morning at 7:20, Nixon, still sleepless, summoned Kissinger, Admiral Tom Moore of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and CIA Director Helms to the White House. In a fury, the president said that Secretary of State Rogers and Secretary of Defense Laird were sabotaging plans for the invasion. Haldeman noted in his diary, "The president is moving too rashly without thinking through the consequences." Kissinger called Helms to ask what he thought of Nixon's decision. CIA Director Helms replied, "It seemed to me that if he was prepared for the fallout, it's the thing to do." He obviously was. "Is it worth it?" Kissinger asked. Helms said he hoped so. Secretary of State Rogers and Secretary of Defense Laird continued to object to the invasion of Cambodia. On April 28th, the president ordered them into the Oval Office. Attorney General John Mitchell laid down the law to them. There would be no arguments. There would be no dissent. In silence, they were dismissed from the Oval Office. Mitchell wrote, quote, "The president stated the purpose of the meeting was to advise those present of the decisions he had reached. There was no discussion." On Thursday, April 30th, after another night with 1 hour of sleep, the president addressed the nation in a nationally televised speech announcing the invasion of Cambodia. Quote, "This is not an invasion of Cambodia," Nixon said, a classic Nixonian contradiction. "I say tonight, all the offers and approaches made previously remain on the conference table whenever Hanoi is ready. But if the enemy response to our most conciliatory offers for peaceful negotiation continues to increase its attack, we shall react accordingly. My fellow Americans, we live in an age of anarchy, both abroad and at home. We see mindless attacks on all the great institutions which have been created by free civilizations in the last 500 years. Even here in the United States, great universities are being systematically destroyed. Small nations from all over the world find themselves attacked from within and from without. If, when the chips are down, the world's most powerful nation, the United States of America, acts like a pitiful, helpless giant, the forces of totalitarianism and anarchy will threaten free nations and free institutions throughout the world." Secretary of State Rogers was in his hideaway office on the 7th floor State Department that night. As Nixon concluded his remarks about the U.S. appearing to be a pitiful, helpless giant, the Secretary of State snapped off the TV set, muttering, quote, "The kids are gonna retch." He saw what lay ahead. The morning after the speech was May Day. The storm had started on the nation's college campuses. College newspapers called for a national student strike. A new march on Washington was set for the coming week. After suffering another insomniac night, Nixon went to the Pentagon, where the Joint Chiefs showed him maps detailing where communist forces occupied Cambodia. They showed four major sanctuaries far beyond the target of the invasion. Quote, "I made a very uncharacteristic on-the-spot decision," Nixon recorded. "I said, I want to take out all those sanctuaries. Make whatever plans are necessary, do it. Knock them all out so they can't be used against us ever." Leaving the briefing, to some of the offers in the Pentagon, the president seemed unhinged. Haldeman concurred, quote, "P was really beat," he wrote in his diary a few hours later, "really needs some good rest." Leaving the briefing, trailed in the lobby of the Pentagon by a few reporters with tape recorders, Nixon compared American soldiers, "they're the greatest," with American students, "these bums blowing up the campuses," a statement he later realized only, quote, added to fuel to the fires of dissent. On Monday, May 4th, Haldeman went to Nixon's executive office building hideout with some bad news. Quote, "Something just came over the wires about a demonstration at Kent State," Haldeman said. "The National Guard opened fire, and some students were shot." "Are they dead?" Nixon asked. "I'm afraid so," Haldeman said. Four had been killed and nine injured by the salvo of gunfire at the Ohio campus. Haldeman's diary recorded the president's reaction. Quote, "He's very disturbed, afraid his decision set it off. Really sad to see this added to his worries about the war. He's out on a tough limb and he knows it. This makes it a lot worse. He has to take the heat for having caused it. He obviously realizes but won't admit his bum's remark was very harmful." In a telephone conversation later that day with Kissinger, Nixon stiffened his spine. "We have to stand hard as a rock," he said. "If countries begin to be run by children, God help us." Kissinger played the tough guy. Haldeman recorded, "Kissinger just wants to let the students go for a couple of weeks, then move in and clobber them." How they could be hit with anything harder than the bullets of the National Guard was not the question. Quote, Kissinger very concerned that we not give in any way. Thinks President can really clobber them if we just wait for Cambodian success. I now quote from a National Security Agency history of the invasion of Cambodia that was declassified a year and a half ago. Quote, the Cambodian incursion was an unmitigated disaster. The most famous or infamous event of the incursion was the attempt to get Khazvan. But Khazvan was always on the move, always able to get out of the way of B-52 strikes, which we, as we know, were predicted with great accuracy by North Vietnamese intelligence, and repeated strikes over the years never did any damage. Kissinger's in-house expert on Hanoi, William Lloyd Stearman, remembered vividly when he heard the reports that Nixon was going after Khazvan. By the time I stopped laughing, I almost felt like crying, Stearman said. I then wondered who the hell had briefed the president on this. It turned out to be Kissinger. Quote, Khazvan was a floating crap game, Stearman said. There was no way you were going to be able to get in and capture it. What did you think Khazvan was about anyway? It was mostly a bunch of huts and some files which could be moved in hours. The press got a hold of this story within 2 weeks. It became common knowledge to the American people, the NSA history recorded. The pressure from the White House and the Pentagon to bomb Khazvan became immense, but the military system was unable. Khazvan was able to evade every B-52 strike and every ground maneuver. The report concludes, this is from the National Security Agency. American bombs tore up miles of jungle and troops floundered through a trackless quagmire of Cambodia in pursuit of Khazvan. They never caught up with the headquarters, which moved safely to central Cambodia ahead of the advancing Allies. Protests against the invasion erupted nationwide, not only students, but university presidents. Not only scraggly leftists, but Wall Street lawyers. Not merely a handful of NSC staffers, but hundreds of State Department officers protested. They openly opposed Nixon's conduct of the war. A national day of protest loomed in a week. Nixon knew he had to mobilize political support from his political allies. Enter Charles W. Colson. The 38-year-old lawyer had signed on as a White House counsel 8 months before as a liaison with labor unions and other special interests. Quote, his instinct for the political jugular, his ability to get things done, made him a lightning rod for my own frustrations, Nixon recorded. When I complained to Colson, I felt confident something would be done. I was rarely disappointed. Colson's job, as he himself put it, was attack and counterattack. And in that role, Nixon said on tape, he'll do anything. I mean anything. Colson now received his first assignment as point man for domestic political warfare. He joined a meeting convened by Nixon in the White House, and taking action in the spirit of Kissinger's encouragement to really clobber the president's political enemies, he telephoned his contacts at the New York City Construction Union Council, led by Peter J. Brennan. On Friday, May 8th, hundreds of hard hats carrying lead pipes and crowbars, attacked anti-war protesters abroad in Wall Streets, cracking heads and breaking bones. More than 70 people were injured. The hard hats got an invitation to the White House, and Brennan became Nixon's labor secretary. As footage of the fracas ran on the evening news, tens of thousands of protesters were gathering in Washington from across the country. Trucks were transporting soldiers to batten down in the executive office building for the night, and two rings of buses barricaded the White House. Nixon was on the verge of a nervous breakdown. He stayed up all night that night, quote, agitated and uneasy, in his own words, frantically making more than 50 telephone calls, and finally calling upon his valet, Manolo Sanchez, to accompany him to the Lincoln Memorial so he could rap with the young people protesting the war. Word spread quickly at 4 a.m. that the president was on the loose amid the hippies. The White House aide, Eagle Bug Krogh, was on duty that night. Krogh vividly recalled, 4:30 in the morning. I was in the Secret Service command post, and over the loudspeaker came the words, "Searchlight is on the lawn." Searchlight being the president's Secret Service code name. I immediately punched in Ehrlichman's home number and said, "The president is out and about. I think he's on the lawn in the Rose Garden." Ehrlichman said, "Go over and render assistance right now." So I tried. I found out where the president was going, and I followed him to the Lincoln Memorial. Couldn't have gotten there more than 5 minutes after he did, and found him in discussion with, at the start, 10 or 15 young people who had come from all over the East Coast to protest the war. The only reliable record of the president's words on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial exists in the real-time accounts of three women who talked face-to-face with him: Lynn Shatskin, Ronnie Kemper, and Joan Pelletier. Quote, "He didn't look anyone in the eyes. He was rambling." Schatzman said, "He mumbled on and on. As far as sentence structure, there was none." "Somebody would ask him to speak up," Kempner said, "and that would jolt him out of wherever he was, and he'd kind of look up and shake his head and go back to wherever he started, but then he'd look at his feet and he was gone again. There was no train of thought." "Nothing he said was coherent," Pelletier wrote. "At first, I felt awe, and that changed right away to respect, and then as he kept talking, it went to disappointment and disillusionment, and then I felt pity, because he was so pathetic, and then just plain fear to think that he was the president running the country." Nixon was, this is Bud Krogh talking again, Nixon was flushed, drawn, exhausted. "I saw him probably the most psychologically exposed, raw day of his presidency." Nixon went to the Capitol at 5:30. He wanted to show his chambers to his valet, Manolo Sanchez, who had never been inside. Haldeman corralled him at 6:15 a.m. The president demanded a plate of corned beef hash at the Mayflower Hotel. He got it. Haldeman urged him to get some rest, but Nixon still could not sleep, and he rattled about the White House all day without purpose as a peaceful protest of 100,000 people swirled around him. Haldeman wrote in his journal that day, "Weirdest day so far. Very weird. President completely beat and just rambling on, but too tired to go to sleep. I am concerned about his condition. He has had very little sleep for a long time." Haldeman added that he had demanded the president take a 5-day weekend in Key Biscayne, but that proved futile. I quote again from Haldeman's recently declassified diaries. "More of the same. He just keeps grinding away. And he won't admit it, but he is letting himself slip back into the old ways." That meant hitting the bottle. Nixon, desperate for respite, was drinking heavily night after night after night. I think we'll stop there. Thank you very much. Fire away.
In a book like this, you do a lot of research before you start writing.
Yes, I do.
Nixon has a lot of men around him.
Yes, he did.
And my question is, what role did Pat Nixon, if any, and any other people that were women play in his life?
Well, Pat Nixon, of course, and Richard Nixon had been married for almost 40 years at this point. Nixon spent far more time with his chief of staff, H.R. Haldeman, than he did with his wife. Theirs was a relationship that had begun with a 2-year futile courtship of Richard Nixon by of Pat Ryan, who finally consented to take his hand. But there was no love. Henry Kissinger once famously said of Richard Nixon, "Can you imagine what this man could have been had anyone ever loved him?"
Thank you.
I was interested in the quotes you gave from the Haldeman diary, which I know nothing about, but he appeared from what you said to be a little different than the hard-nosed people that you think of surrounding Nixon. And I'm wondering just generally what you think of Haldeman and what his role really was.
Well, anybody who remembers Haldeman remembers that he had a military buzz cut and looked tough as nails. He wrote and recorded a diary every day, and he spent sometimes 5 and 6 hours a day with the president. His diaries, written and recorded, run to nearly 1 million words. Some of them were, about a quarter of them were classified top secret until last year. He was very funny. He was very smart. Like many of the men who served Richard Nixon, he was loyal to the point of zealotry. Blindly loyal. And for his loyalty, he went to prison. His diaries make amazing reading. They are smart, they are funny, they are vivid, and they are heartbreaking.
I never thought I'd say this, but you might have given me the only reason I can think of to vote for Donald Trump. I'd love to see your book.
You're on. All right.
I'd love to see your book on the Trump presidency. I saw you and Evan Thomas on Charlie Rose recently. Very good discussion. I've read Evan's book. I haven't read your book, but I want to read your.
They're very different.
You took the words out of my mouth. Thomas, I don't know how much of a stretch it is, but he really seems to reach for some...
Speak up, please. Just lean into the mic.
Oh, okay. I don't know how much of a stretch it was, but Thomas really seems to reach for some positive things.
The lighter side of Richard Nixon.
Well, no, the positive things. The Environmental Protection Agency, the EEOC. He cites, and I'd appreciate your comment on this, the dramatic desegregation of Southern schools under Nixon. Now, it was initiated, obviously, by Johnson.
Initiated by the Supreme Court.
Okay. But nevertheless, there was a dramatic move during the Nixon administration, correct?
There was some change.
Okay.
Can I?
Thomas says it's dramatic.
Okay. We're still working on race issues in this country, 50 years after the fact.
Absolutely.
As Nixon would say, let me say this about that. Richard Nixon signed the Environmental Protection Act because Congress had passed it by veto-proof majorities, and the American people marched 1 million of them on Earth Day in April 1970, immediately before the events recorded here, the invasion of Cambodia. He said on tape, "The environment is not an issue worth a damn to us. The liberals and the left want to use it to screw corporate America." But he signed it nonetheless. He had no choice.
Okay. All right.
As far as desegregation goes, the Supreme Court had, by this time, issued 15 years of decisions saying the United States had to move, you remember Brown versus Board of Education, quote, with all deliberate speed. 15 years later, they were moving very slowly with all deliberate speed. You'll remember that President Eisenhower, when Nixon was vice president, sent federal troops to Arkansas to desegregate the schools. Okay? This is only 12 years later. It is true that there was desegregation under Nixon. There was also fantastic resistance within the White House to doing this. Nixon tried to have it both ways, right? But he said himself, "I can't talk to black people unless they're Uncle Tom's." That's on tape. And the only black official who ever served under Nixon, James Farmer at HEW, said Nixon believed in nothing. He did whatever was politically expedient. That's what's on the record.
Okay. Let me just ask one question. You've obviously done an extensive amount of research on Nixon. Could I ask you to cite 5 positive personal traits?
No man could father two brilliant, beautiful daughters, Julie and Patricia.
Is that two?
And right? Be all bad. That's two.
That's two. I don't like the way you count.
Okay, that's two. Nixon genuinely believed that he could be a world figure who could change history. That's where the title of my book comes from, One Man Against the World. He genuinely believed that he could end the Vietnam War by going to China, going to Moscow, clinking glasses with the communist tyrants of the two greatest communist powers on earth, and somehow change the world and end the war. So he had a grand strategy. It didn't work, but you can credit him for having a huge dynamic vision.
Well, hopefully all presidents have that same aspiration.
Not all of them. Okay. Okay, fourth. He had the good grace to realize that it was in the interests of the United States to leave and not put us through the agony of an impeachment and conviction in the Senate. All right? That took personal courage.
Yep.
And humility. No president has ever stepped down willingly from office. Can you imagine what we had would have gone through, you know, as our bicentennial approached? There had been an impeachment in Congress, which there would have been, and conviction in the Senate, which there would have been.
Right.
Okay, that's four. Let me think. Well, he did get rid of Agnew, that's true, but only after Agnew pleaded no contest to evading taxes on bribes he took when he was vice president. So let's call that four and a half.
He was a good piano player.
He played, but only in the key of G. He could play anything but in the key of G. That's the best I can do off the top of my head. Thank you.
In your book, one of the most interesting people, I guess, and most confusing was Kissinger, Henry Kissinger.
Yeah.
What could you comment on your feelings as his role as an enabler?
Yes.
But also what was real about him and not, because I got a very confused feel.
Kissinger is a very confusing person, especially if you read his memoirs. But let me try to explain. I have interviewed Kissinger, and in fact, my mother was born 11 months after Henry Kissinger in the same little town outside of Nuremberg. Und so. I know where he came from. I know what he went through fleeing Nazi Germany. I know that he had a deep sense that history was a tragedy, and that human beings were fatally flawed. Kissinger, you have to understand, was the tactician. Nixon was the strategist. This is why I told the gentleman that I think Nixon's grand strategy is something you have to admire, even though in the end he failed. Kissinger is probably tied for first place among the reasons that Nixon started taping himself in the White House. This is hard to understand, but it's the truth. Nixon installed the taping system, and it wasn't just the White House. It was the White House, it was the Executive Office Building, it was Camp David eventually, it was all the telephones, for two reasons. One, he thought that no one would ever find out about them until after he left office, and he could write a multi-million dollar presidential memoir based on the tapes, and they would be a defense against the inevitable memoirs of Henry Kissinger. No Washington memoirist ever makes himself come out to be anything less than a brilliant man. Kissinger was interested in power. And through proximity to power, through proximity to the president, and unflagging work, he rose a German refugee to become the Secretary of State under Nixon, for better or for worse.
I have a follow-up question that
yes, sir.
For your previous response. I understand why Nixon made the tapes. What I've never understood is why he kept the tapes.
And I can tell you.
Please.
On tape, Nixon said, "Should have destroyed the tapes."
Yeah, right.
After their existence was revealed. Okay, why didn't he do it? He never believed that the Supreme Court would ever rule 8-0 that he had to turn them over. Couldn't even conceive of it. Okay, second of all, this was the dilemma, and this is also recorded on tape. Only Nixon could have destroyed the tapes, claiming that they were his executive property and by executive privilege, he could destroy them, erase them, or, you know, make confetti out of them. Okay, but he didn't. Then the question became, no one knew what was on these tapes. Well, he did, and then sometimes he forgot that the tapes were rolling. And so then the question became, after their existence was exposed at the Watergate hearings by one of the four people who knew that they existed, what are we going to do with them? The president's lawyers meet in the White House, and they say, are we going to have a bonfire on the White House lawn of these 4,000 hours of tapes? Who's going to strike the match? King Timahoe? That was the president's not very faithful Irish setter. Anyone who was not the president who struck the match would have instantly been indicted for obstruction of justice. Because some of these tapes were under subpoena as soon as their existence was known.
Do you have anything on the sabotaging of the peace negotiations, the Vietnamese?
Hell yeah.
I kind of figured.
Yeah.
I mean, because to me, it's like makes Watergate look like child's play.
It does.
I mean,
it's chapter 3 of the book, in case you're interested. The gentleman is referring to, in the weeks before the 1968 election, President Johnson was trying to negotiate a ceasefire, and he called a bombing halt in Vietnam. And Nixon, from the summer onward, had been in contact with the embassy of South Vietnam through his campaign manager, later Attorney General John Mitchell, sending word through the South Vietnamese embassy here in Washington to the presidential palace in Saigon, don't make a deal with the Democrats or with Hubert Humphrey, Nixon's opponent in the 1968 election and LBJ's vice president. Wait for us. We'll get you a better deal. Okay. Lyndon Johnson knew about this because the FBI had the South Vietnamese embassy in Washington wired and the NSA had the presidential palace in Saigon wired. Okay, so they were hearing both ends of the conversation where the South Vietnamese ambassador is getting communications from the president of South Vietnam, President Thieu, and they're talking back and forth and the ambassador is saying, listen, Nixon says, wait, get a better deal. Okay, and Thieu says, absolutely, I totally agree. And on the eve of the presidential election, this close to a deal in Paris, the South Vietnamese walk. And Lyndon Johnson, who recorded his telephone calls, says 5 days before the presidential election, and I quote, this is treason. It is definitely against the law. It's called the Logan Act. It was passed in 1798. For a private citizen to conduct diplomacy on behalf of the United States. If this had come out, it would have swung the election, which was going like, I mean, the polls were going like this. And in the end, Nixon won by 0.7% of the vote. But the evidence was too secret to reveal on the eve of a presidential election. It had been gathered by the NSA. Nobody knew what the NSA was. People thought the initial stood for no such agency. And to admit that the FBI was tapping the South Vietnamese, Johnson has a war council. The Secretary of Defense is there, the Secretary of State is there, his National Security Advisor is there, and they all say, we can't do this. Okay? It'll blow the country up. And it had already been a pretty bad year in 1968. Bobby Kennedy had been murdered, Martin Luther King had been murdered. If on the eve of the presidential election, the president is saying that his political opponent has committed a federal offense by sabotaging the peace negotiations, the country is going to be torn apart even worse than it is, which is hard to imagine, if you remember 1968. Anyway, it's all down in black and white. It's all recorded, and it's a pretty terrifying story.
Did Humphrey know before the election?
After.
After. Okay, I thought it was before.
Yeah, but LBJ knew. And he was righteously angry. Yes, ma'am.
It was obvious to many people in the White House and to his staff that Nixon was unhinged, seriously unhinged. And I'm wondering, is there anything in the Constitution to remove someone who was so seriously mentally disturbed, aside from impeachment? Like, isn't there a White House?
No, well, no.
He
took a lot of sleeping pills on top of the insomnia, on top of the alcohol. But the Constitution says that the president can only be removed if he is literally, you know, non compos mentis and, you know, on his hospital bed dying. If you know your history, you know that Woodrow Wilson spent a year and a half, you know, unable to speak because of a stroke right after World War I, but nobody knew about it. Okay. The 25th Amendment says the president can be replaced if he is essentially unable to carry out his duties because of physical illness. It doesn't say anything about if the president is nuts.
Time for an amendment?
Good luck getting that passed, because you kind of have to be nuts to run for president nowadays.
Thank you.
Sir.
With respect to your saying that one of the four and a half positive things Richard Nixon did was to step down rather than go through impeachment, my question is, did Richard Nixon know Ford was going to
pardon him
before he stepped down?
Very interesting question. The question had been broached a week before Nixon left office by his new chief of staff, General Alexander Haig, who, by the way, is the only person who ever went from colonel to four-star general in 5 years without being in combat, unless you count political combat. It's ambiguous. The evidence is ambiguous. President Ford absolutely denied it on a stack of Bibles that there was any deal cut. Here was the dilemma that he faced. If Ford hadn't pardoned Nixon, there isn't any question that Nixon would have been indicted for obstruction of justice, among other crimes. That would have been a pretty ugly process as our bicentennial anniversary approached. There is no precedent for that in American history, the criminal conviction of a former president. So Ford was trying to, as he put it, bind up the nation's wounds, say our long national nightmare is over, let's put this behind us. He thought he was doing the right thing. He guaranteed that he would not be elected in his own right 2 years later. But I actually asked Jerry Ford this question face to face in 1982. And I'm almost repeating verbatim what he said, as I recall it. He said, the country had been through so much pain, why prolong the suffering? That's the best we know.
Hi.
Hello.
One of the questions I've thought about from time to time is whether Nixon's behavior during the time you've covered could perhaps have been explained by a thorough analysis and unbiased analysis of his behavior earlier in his career. For example, take Jerry Voorhees. He won because he called him a communist. Helen Hagen Douglas, same thing. The Whitaker Chambers business, that made Nixon.
Yes.
I wondered if he had some role in the Pumpkin Papers. I don't know.
He had a big role in it.
Well, I mean, in were they real is what I'm asking.
Well, Alger Hiss was guilty. But again, as in the Paris Peace Talks case, the evidence was too secret to reveal in court. Hiss was convicted of perjury, had a second trial by denying that he had ever been a member of the Communist Party. He was never convicted of espionage.
Yeah. Okay. And for years, he wrote a book which is unreadable. How innocent he was.
Yes. Yeah. No. The evidence was declassified when the Cold War was over, and there's no question that Alger Hiss worked for the Soviet underground from 1932 to 1936. Okay. However, for a lot of Americans, was anyone here remember the 1930s? Put up your hands. Anybody? Okay. There was a real question as to whether Hitler or Stalin was going to run the world, right? So some people picked sides. It was kind of a terrible choice anyway you cut it.
I wasn't raising the question of Hiss's perjury. I was really trying to raise the question
of Nixon's
role in the Pumpkin Papers.
It was crucial.
Yeah.
It was crucial, and it made Richard Nixon internationally famous.
Yeah, right.
He became tied for first place with J. Edgar Hoover as the most famous anti-communist in America.
Yeah.
He'd been in Congress for 4 years, and then he became Ike's vice president.
Yeah.
That's a pretty rapid rise from nowhere.
With the help of Prescott Bush.
They didn't actually get along that well. Prescott Bush belonged to that now extinct breed called a liberal Republican.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else? Any questions? Yes, step right up, sir.
Hello.
Hello. My dear Uncle Tim, I was just wondering... Cat's out the bag. So I'm about 200 pages into the book, and I was telling my friends and my family that I'm surprised by the scope or, you know, the narrative that you've chosen for this, in the sense that Nixon's president by page 30, by page 200, Vietnam has dominated the narrative. You know, even events like going to China get relatively little coverage. And on page 200 it says, you know, today is the day that Watergate was broken into. So... You know, this makes it a pretty particular scope in my opinion. It, even to call it a biography of Nixon's presidency might be too broad. So, we all know now about how you went through a lot of, you know, recently declassified material, tons of, obviously tons of primary sources, what have you. At what point, or what was your reasoning behind the decision to ultimately focus on, you know, the two most devastating aspects of his presidency? And take it from there.
I will tell you. When you look at the newly declassified records, which are 40 and 50 years old in some cases, you finally understand, or at least I finally understood, and I've been trying to understand Richard Nixon for quite some time now, how the Vietnam War turned into Watergate. Nixon was fighting two wars at once. In Vietnam, his weapons were B-52 bombers. At home, he was fighting his political enemies. Anybody who opposed the war, anybody who had ever voted against him, he was only elected by a bare plurality of 42.7% of the vote in 68. Anybody who was against him was an enemy, and he used different weapons. He couldn't use B-52 bombers at home. He used bugs, burglaries, break-ins, black bag jobs, and political sabotage to destroy his enemies. In the end, that's what brought him down, trying to fight the war at home. And that's what I really learned from the new material.
Any more relatives want to ask a question?
I didn't set that up. Sir.
Okay, we got time for one more.
Okay, make it a doozy.
A doozy. But the tapes demonstrate this really unsavory strain of anti-Semitism in Nixon. And yet, a number of his closest advisors were Jews. Of course, Kissinger, Sapphire, Garment, a number of others. And then... When Israel was in deep trouble in 73, Nixon really pulled Israel out of the fire,
yep,
so to speak. So how do you reconcile this?
I think you're talking about two different strains in the man's character and the man's actions, okay? Nixon was a hater. Okay? It's all on tape. He hated blacks. He hated Jews. He hated liberals. And once you were on his you-know-what list, let's just say his enemies list, you were there for life. On the other hand, you know, the United States had supported the creation of the State of Israel in the year Nixon came to Congress. The United States had never wavered in that support. And in those days, the Egyptians and the Syrians were supported by the Soviets. Okay. Now, there's a terrible moment during the 1973 war, the Yom Kippur War that you refer to, when, indeed, after a number of snafus, an emergency airlift of weapons was organized from the United States to Tel Aviv. The Soviets are detected by American intelligence sensors shipping nuclear warheads through the Dardanelles into the Mediterranean. The National Security Council, Kissinger, CIA director, chairman of the Joint Chiefs meet. Nixon is non compos mentis because that week had come the Saturday night massacre in which the attorney general and the assistant attorney general quit because Nixon ordered them against law to fire the special prosecutor investigating Watergate. So while this crisis is happening, Nixon's upstairs drunk in the residence, non compos mentis, and six unelected officials put the United States on a nuclear alert, one step short of imminent nuclear war. So there was some decision-making that was just part of American foreign policy, okay, that went contrary to his own biases against what he called the establishment. I mean, he didn't like people who went to Harvard. He didn't like people who were, quote, intellectuals, or quote. He told Kissinger several times to his face, you know, about his dislike for Jews, and he said, write this on the blackboard 100 times. The press is the enemy. The professors are the enemy. The establishment is the enemy. Never forget it. That's the true Richard Nixon on tape. Thank you very much for coming.